Hello, welcome to the Church of England online service for Sunday, the 24th of September. It's Generosity Week. My name's Mark Miller and I'm the vicar of Stockton Parish Church.
My name's Katy and I'm part of the leadership team here. We are out on Stockton High Street and it's great to welcome you to our town this morning.
With God, nothing will be impossible.
For he is our God.
And the God of salvation is making all things new.
Amen.
We are gathered together to worship the Lord Jesus, to come before him, to learn more of him, to be changed by him, and to head out into the world to change it for his work and for his goodness and his glory. So why don't we head on into the church where the band are ready to lead us in musical worship.
Let's take a moment to posture ourselves to worship. Why don't you join me as I pray? Jesus, we lift you high today. You are great above all things, and it is you who we praise. You are mighty to save, and we will worship you. Amen.
Come, let us worship our King. Come, let us bow at his feet. He has done great things. See what our Savior has done. See how his love overcomes. He has done great things. He has done great things. Oh, hero of heaven, you conquered the grave. You free every captive and break every chain. Oh God, you have done great. You'll be faithful forevermore. You have done great things, and I know you will do it again. For your promise is yes and amen. You will do great things. God, you do great things. Above it all, hallelujah, God, unshakable, hallelujah, you have done great things. Hallelujah, God, above it all, hallelujah, God, unshakable. And break every chain, oh God. You have done great things. We dance in your freedom, awake and alive. God, you do great cry out to worship, whose glory taught the stars to shine. There isn't time enough to sing of all you've done, but this joy is mine. With a thousand this song is forever yours. A thousand hallelujahs, a thousand more. Who else would die for our redemption? Whose resurrection means our with
Lord Jesus, this song is forever yours. A thousand hallelujahs, a thousand more.
Jesus, we give you every hallelujah, for you are worthy of it all. Thank you that it is a sweet, sweet sound to your ear. Amen.
Let us affirm our faith using the words of the Apostle Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died and buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He's seated at the right hand of God the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communions of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
And now, brothers and sisters, we want you to know about the grace that God has given the Macedonian churches. In the midst of a very severe trial, their overflowing joy and their extreme poverty welled up in rich generosity. For I testify that they gave us as much as they were able, and even beyond their ability, entirely on their own. They urgently pleaded with us for the privilege of sharing in this service to the Lord's people, and they exceeded our expectations. They gave themselves first of all to the Lord, and then by the will of God also to us. So we urge Titus, just as he had earlier made a beginning, to bring also to completion this act of grace upon your part. But since you excel in everything, in faith, in speech, in knowledge, in complete earnestness, and in love we have kindled in you, see that you also excel in this grace of giving.
Richie, what was life like before you knew Jesus in your life?
Life was chaotic. It was tough growing up, tough before, even in my teens when I started doing drugs and then moving on to football violence, Middlesbrough frontline, and then even that wasn't enough. I was just always searching for a love that never came, and it was bad.
The football violence things, you know, for lots of people, it's like, what, really? You were trying to find love through football violence?
Yeah, through acceptance, because you get that acceptance, even though it's nonsense looking back, but you get that acceptance. People want you to be around them, and you're going to different places with your football team, etc. And you're not even interested in football, really. You're just interested in that violence part.
What happened to start changing your life?
So I was in a failed relationship where my girlfriend cheated on me, and then once a trust goes, it's difficult to get back. So, and then I found out that I couldn't have children as well, which made it a lot harder. And then I kind of blamed my parents for that. So then I was just going out every other weekend, binge drinking, taking cocaine, and then I lost a few friends to suicide. So that was difficult. Then I was just searching for something. And I remember reading this book. I'd read this book years ago. And then I heard that the person whose book it was about was going to be speaking in the parish garden, so I thought, you know what, I'm going to go along, see what it's about, and then
What was the book?
The book was Gram Seeds. I can't remember the name of it.
But it was Gram Seeds' story.
Yeah.
And so tell us what happened. You went along to the parish gardens. Gram Seed was speaking. What happened?
Yeah, there was loads of Americans there. That was strange. It was pouring down, so I stood at the back. And then at the end, an American pastor asked if anyone wanted to give their life to Jesus, which I just felt a force push me forward. There was no one behind me though, and I felt my legs being walked for me. So yeah, then I give my life to Jesus, but yeah.
So that sounds then that everything was now great again?
No, I wish.
Really?
Yeah.
Tell us what happened.
So that was like 7 years ago, I think now, 2016, yeah, 7 years ago. And I felt like a hypocrite because I was going to church every week. And people were there and they had this love and always happy. But I never felt it. I just didn't get it for 6 years. 6 years I went to church. Not every week, but some weeks I'd fall away again and get drunk and do other things. And yeah, it was difficult. I just didn't get it. I didn't think Jesus wanted anything to do with me, really. I didn't get it at all.
So I know you do get it now. What changed? Where was the change in that?
The change comes when I just got to a point where I had to say, Lord, if you're real, I want it all. I'm either all in or I'm all out. And he was like, all right then. And see that you want it. So then he sent a word for me, which I didn't think was for me at first. And then I get up. I'm sat there and the Lord speak and I hear his voice clearly in my ear say, it's for you, Rich, you need to get up. And I was like, nah. He said it 3 times and then I got up and got prayer for that word, which was all in. But that still wasn't enough. So that week I was praying. I was like, Lord, I've said it. I'm all in loads of times and never been all in. So you're going to have to send someone to help me. And the very next week, someone from church, John Cotty, came over to me and said, Rich, I've been thinking for a while about doing a discipleship course and your name has come into my mind. See, God knew, but he knew it would take 6 years to change things in my life. He'd give me a conscience. He'd give me a new heart in them 6 years. I see things differently and he knew it was right and he knew when I was going to ask then. But he was just waiting for me to ask and then he sent someone to help me.
So what difference has that made in your life?
Oh man, that's mint, you know. So I learned how to have fellowship with people. I got new friends. I learned how to read the Bible. Knew about giving, about generosity. God is good, man. God's mint. I love him. I love him more than anything.
Richie, it's great to hear that. This week, the online service has got a generosity theme. How has Jesus changed your approach to money?
Oh, massively. See, I just, the more money I had, the more I spent, and I didn't care what I spent it on. So then God took me back a bit, so I wasn't earning that much in my last job. So you learn how to budget your money more, and then giving people who are less fortunate than yourself, you know, when you give, you think you're going to be short, but you're not, because then God just gives you it back like tenfold, and you don't even know where it comes from half the time, and you're like, all right, cheers, God, you know. It's just, so now, and he's, by being faithful to God and following him, he's given me a better job where I get a better pay. So then you can give more to others. I love giving, helping others. Even though I still don't have a lot for myself, I just help where I can and give more. So my money's not important, but it's good to have if you can help other people less fortunate than yourself.
The parable of the rich fool. Someone in the crowd said to him, Teacher, tell my brother to divide the inheritance with me. Jesus replied, Man, who appointed me judge or arbiter between you? Then he said to them, Watch out, be on your guard against all kinds of greed. Life does not consist in an abundance of your possessions. And he told them this parable. The ground of a certain rich man yielded an abundant harvest. He thought to himself, What shall I do? I have no place to store my crops. Then he said, This is what I'll do. I will tear down my barns and build bigger ones, and there I will store my surplus grain. And I said to myself, You have plenty of grain laid up for many years. Take life easy, eat, drink, and be merry. But God said to him, You fool, this very night your life will be demanded from you. Then who will get what you have prepared for yourself? This is how it will be with whoever stores up things for themselves, but is not rich towards God. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
I'm really excited to speak to you today. And I want to ask you to partner with God and with the whole of his church as we see his will being done and his kingdom coming on earth as it is in heaven. Let's look at the reading we've heard from Luke's Gospel about the man who wanted more. Jesus taught more about money and possessions than he did about almost every subject. More than sex, more than hell, more than salvation. I think there's a really good reason for that. It's because he knows that we would struggle with money and greed more than just about anything else. One of the most important points that Jesus makes about money is this. He said we can either love God or we can love money, but we cannot love both. And in today's reading, the man asked Jesus to help him get more money and more possessions. In response, Jesus tells a story of a wealthy man who builds up for himself treasures on earth. He builds up great wealth, which he spends on himself. God says, "You fool, this very night your life will end, and then what will you have?" And then Jesus gives a serious warning. This is how it will be for anyone who stores up things for themselves. Jesus does not mess about when he's teaching about money. And so I don't think we should be shy about it either. I've been at SPC for 11 years and I've had people asking me how to read the Bible, how to pray, for advice with their relationships. I've never had anyone come and say that they are struggling with greed or with materialism or with a lack of generosity. But I don't think it's because greed and materialism aren't problems for them. Jesus said that the truth will set you free, but someone has also said that before it sets you free, it's going to really annoy you. Now, I haven't always understood the importance of giving financially to God's kingdom through his church. For a long time, if I'd been in church and I'd heard things like this, "Well, who loves God?" I'd say, "It's me." "Who wants to worship with all their life?" I'd say, "It's me." "Who loves Jesus more than their family?" Well, you know, I could have said, "Me." "Who wants to give their whole life to God?" "It's me." "Who accepts Jesus as the Lord of their life?" "Me." "Who will let Jesus be the Lord of their finances?" Well, is that an imaginary question? Do you mean right now or at some point in the future? Is this a serious question? And I'm going to have to think about it for quite a long time. I struggled with this because I saw all my money as, well, as mine. Money gives us a sense of freedom, of power, control, or at least we think it does. Money gives the hope of happiness, but it never quite delivers. I think that the reason Jesus taught us so much about money is not because he's interested in money, but because he's interested in us, in you and in me. One of the lies about money and possessions is, if you have more, you'll be happier. Money is a great deceiver. If you have a small amount, it will say, "If you had more, you'd be happier." And if you have a lot, it will say, "If you had more, you'd be even happier." And when we listen to that voice, we can get into trouble. There is a huge temptation to always want more, to spend beyond our means. My wife and I have been there. When we were younger, we spent more than we had, and it took us years to pay the debts off, and it affected our ability to give to the church. Before I go any further with this talk, please, if you are in debt and you don't know what to do, would you go and talk to somebody? Maybe you could get in touch with CAP, Christians Against Poverty, who I guarantee you will be able to help you. Happiness comes from accepting what we have, not getting what we don't have. Let me give you an example. Who do you think is the happiest? Do you think the winner of the gold medal, the silver medal, or the bronze medal? Well, obviously, it's the gold medal winner. But who do you think is next happiest? Well, research has demonstrated that it is usually the bronze medalist that is happiest. The silver medalist is unhappy because they didn't get a gold. They were focused on what they didn't get. But the bronze medalist is happy because they got a medal. Don't listen to the lie that says you need more to be happy. Let's go back to today's reading, the parable of the wealthy man. He says, myself. He starts with an abundance and ends up with nothing. He has only been interested in himself and what he wants. How do we avoid being like the man in the story? How do we avoid being self-centered, greedy people only interested in what we want? Well, the answer to most questions a vicar asks is Jesus. Of course the answer is Jesus. We are to be like Jesus. Jesus is a generous giver. He is the most generous giver of all. We often sing songs about his generosity, the breath in our lungs being given by Jesus, our very lives sustained by the one who brought all life into being. Jesus gave his life for each one of us so that we would know what it means to live life in all of its fullness, so that we would live lives of peace and freedom, and with the sure and certain hope of an eternity in his presence. We are Jesus's treasured possession. He has eyes firmly fixed on us, nurturing us, ministering to us, blessing us. And we are able to partner with him in the transformation of this world. Giving to the work of God's kingdom through his church is not an add-on to the Christian faith. It is a key spiritual discipline in our discipleship journey. That's why we honor it with time in our services every Sunday. I believe that our spiritual need to give, my spiritual need to give, is far, far greater than the church's need to receive. This is not about the church having enough money. This is about our development as disciples. Sometimes we can get caught up in, I can't give and so I will serve. But actually, it's not an either or, it's a both and. Let me give you three key principles about giving financially to God's church. Our giving should be generous, it should be sacrificial, and it should be joyful. Let me break that down for you. It should be generous. God gives to us generously, so we should give back to him generously. The question, how much should I give, is a very common question. There's a great biblical principle of tithing, that is, giving 10% of all we have. It's most often found in the Old Testament, although Jesus mentioned it as well. However, the teaching in the New Testament suggests that we're no longer limited to 10%. We can give more than that. But even giving a figure to the question, how much should I give, can cause problems. I heard about someone who was trying to figure this out, and they spoke to their vicar and said, this 10%, is it before tax or after tax? Is it just what I earn or is it everything? Is it the financial year or the calendar year? Now, the vicar was very gracious and very wise and answered, are you trying to work out what is the least you can give and still be considered a generous giver? To which the man said, yes. Now, this vicar's advice, which I found very helpful, said, when you start to give generously, you're on a journey. So just start. Start to give and start to flex your generosity muscle and see what God does with you. If this talk about money and your relationship with money is making sense, but you're still holding back from making a commitment to give generously to God's kingdom through his church, just start. Start with something and ask God to grow your generosity muscles. That's what I've done over the years, and now I give at least 10% before tax. And do you know, God has done something with my generosity muscles. They are far more flexible and stronger than ever before. And secondly, our giving should be sacrificial. There's a simple principle that I've found very helpful here. If I'm not missing it, I'm probably not giving it enough. If I'm giving to God after I've given to myself, I'm not putting him first in my life. If I give to God out of what I have left over, rather than giving to him of my best, of what I start with, then I have my priorities twisted. They're the wrong way around. The Old Testament would talk about first fruits, giving to God first from our finest harvest. We can get caught up on the amount that we give, yet Jesus made it really clear that it wasn't about the amount, it was about the heart. We can get deceived into thinking that because we only have a small amount to give, because we don't have very much, then our offering doesn't matter. The truth is that if we give a lot out of our little, then out of our little, God can do a lot. So many great acts of faith began with small acts of obedience. And the final giving principle is joyfully. The Lord loves a cheerful giver. It is a privilege to partner with God, the creator of the universe, and our brothers and sisters with whom we will spend all eternity by investing in the amazing kingdom of God. When we give cheerfully, God does something incredible inside us. He changes our perspective and our desires. Our internal perspective begins to impact our earthly decisions. I wonder if you agree with everything I've said today, but there is still something holding you back from giving generously, sacrificially, and joyfully. Let me pray. Father, would you give us generous hearts? Would you give us a confidence and a faith to trust you with our finances? Would you build in us generous, sacrificial, joyful attitudes to giving? And Father, if anybody is engaging with this service today and does not know you, would you reveal yourself to them? Would you encourage them to take a step of faith and to follow you? Come, Lord Jesus, I pray. Amen.
I just want to speak the name of Jesus over every heart and every mind. 'Cause I know there is peace within your presence. I speak Jesus. I just want to speak the name of Jesus till every dark addiction starts to break, and declaring there is hope and there is freedom, I speak Jesus. Your name is power, your name is healing, your name is life. Break every stronghold,
Jesus, thank you that you are a generous God, that you're a God who invites us to partner with him, and that when we speak your name, we find peace, we find love, and we find healing. Thank you, Lord, for reminding us to be sacrificial in our giving, the way that you've shown us through your cross. Father, help us through your Holy Spirit and convict us for all that we can contribute financially for your glory and for building your kingdom. We thank you, Lord, that you are a faithful and gracious God, and that in all we do, you're always there. You're always faithful. And so we give you all the glory and thank you. Amen.
Shout Jesus from the mountains, Jesus in the streets, Jesus in the darkness over every enemy. Jesus for my family, I speak the holy name, Jesus.
Shout Jesus from the mountains, Jesus in the streets, Jesus in the darkness over every enemy. Jesus for my family, I speak the holy name, Jesus.
Your name is healing. Your name is life. Break every stronghold. Shine through the shadows. Burn like a fire.
Thank you for joining us today for this Church of England online service in Generosity Week. It's been our delight to host you here at Stockton Parish Church.
As we finish, we are going to pray a prayer that sends us out into the week ahead. So will you join me as we pray? Father, help me to live this week to the full, being true to you in every way. Jesus, help me to give myself away to others, being kind to everyone I meet. Spirit, help me to love the lost, proclaiming Christ in all I do and say. Amen. We're going to worship as we finish, so will you stand and join us?
There's no one like Jesus. There's no one like him. There's no one like Jesus. There's no one like him. There's no one like Jesus. There's no one. There's no one like him. There's no one. There's no one. There's no one like Jesus. There's no one. There's no one. There's no one like. Oh, there's no one. There's no one. There's no one like Jesus. There's no one. There's no one. There's no one like him. There's no one. There's no one. There's no one like Jesus. There's no one. There's no one. There's no one. No one, no one. I turn around and no one, no one. There's no one, there's no one. Man. In Malawi, Palibe wo fana ndi Yesu, Palibe wo fana na Yesu, Palibe wo fana ni Yesu. Saza peze kaso.
I will.